Go ahead and get this thing started. Mm-hmm. As always, every week, you guys, welcome to the couch where your mental health matters. So can we talk for a bit? I'm your host, Damion, of course, aka Dame Dash. I got my girl Jackie on the other end, my favorite co-host. She's in the building, Jaqueline, aka
I'm ready for aka Damn it, Jackie.
Yes, Damn it, Jackie.
Okay, sorry, I shook the table. I was
She's
ready
shaking
for that
the
one.
Table. I'm always ready She's for shaking that. The table. But we're definitely in the building. As always, we got another exciting topic today. This was actually Jaqueline's idea. So
yeah, it was my idea.
Yeah, it was great.
That's yes. Great. I'm ready to unveil some things.
Yeah, so okay. So as you guys see, we have a guest visitor of the couch family, more closer than you know. And we're going to get into that. So let's introduce Miss Diane.
Hi, everybody.
And Miss Diane, could you let our couch family know and our friends know who you are and why you're here?
I am Jacqueline's first mother, and I'm here to talk about adoption, and I'm here to talk about birth mothers and children of birth mothers and families of both.
Yeah. This should be a great topic, and it's something that we often kind of, I guess maybe it's not really hush, but it's not talked about a lot.
I think it's hush. A lot of people don't talk about it.
I think, is it not our perception that people want to be quiet about it?
Mm-hmm.
People want to be quiet about it. I don't think anyone, I'm just saying, Damien, because I want to respond directly to that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because that's your opinion, which makes sense from where you sit. But from where I sit, it is not even something that is much discussed in my own family. And I'm not going to get into details about that, but everyone doesn't have great feelings about me openly discussing this in my life. So, but I'm okay saying that too, because that's what's going on.
Right.
So,
right. Okay. Yeah. So as always, you guys, you know, we converse here on the couch on every episode when we're live. You guys talk to each other. You guys talk to us. We talk to each other. We talk to you guys. So we definitely want to hear you guys' feedback, comments, questions, your experiences as well. Definitely if you have an experience in this arena of adoption, whether you've been adopted or you're an adoptive parent or you're a birth mother as well. So any of those, definitely we want to hear your feedback and let's have a conversation about it, because, of course, this is what we do on the couch. We talk.
Can we just talk about... You don't know the rest of
this,
Diane?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I didn't either! I hear it in my car, but I'm like...
You know the words in the shower or in the car.
I talk about...
Yeah. So, while I got my background singers, you know what I'm saying? So, of course, today, as we expressed on our post, you know, throughout this week so far, we're going to be talking about the psychological effects that adoption has on the birth parent as well as the child that's being adopted. So we're definitely going to dive into that. Of course, if you guys have any questions, please make sure go ahead and type it on there. We'll definitely see them. I can't see that far because I don't have my glasses on, but Jackie has.
Yeah, I'm checking the comments.
Yeah, for sure. So each and every week, of course, we have our Wendy Williams segment that we call the Mental Health Trending Topic of the Week. And our Wendy Williams correspondent, Damn it, Jackie over here, usually has her little rant, positive rants, informative rants. That's what we said. We said informative rants.
Sure there.
Yeah. About a particular topic. And as always, we say any and everything mental health, because everything is mental health related. It all starts with the mind.
Yeah.
So, this week, what do we got, Ms. Jackie? Is that trending topic?
A little nervous because we didn't really agree when I gave you a few ideas before the show, and I want to make sure I bring up a good one. So which one do you want to go with, Dame? I'm tossing that back to you. Okay, let's talk about Tisha Campbell on The View. I think that that was very moving, and there's a lot of other things going on in the media right now that I would rather not focus on at the beginning of this show. This is a heartfelt family show today, and I don't want to talk about death, murder of another young black person today. Yes. I want to give light to it, shed light on it, and give attention to it, but the mental space I'm in at this moment, I would rather not dwell on that.
Okay.
I would rather talk about Tisha Campbell meeting her sister on The View. I don't know. Did you guys see that?
I did. I saw the video that you shared to me.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you for acknowledging that.
Yes.
I put Damion onto that clip. So, I appreciate my
credit. What does that mean?
I don't know.
Oh, okay. She put me on, you guys. She put me
on. Put Damion onto that clip today. It was heartfelt. What did you think about it?
I felt like it was really, really good. I mean, for people to see it. For it to be out.
Do you mean the moment of recognition of and bringing that out in the open?
Yeah. Oh yeah, sure. That's exactly what I feel. I feel, you know, not a lot of people talk about it, and you realize that once you start talking to people, you really realize that.
Do you think it's more prominent in black families?
As far as adoption.
As far as, let's talk about this: adoption and secret relatives.
I think that we have more secret adoptions within families.
Secret adoptions. Within families.
So it's like the mom was too young, and then the grandmother or the auntie, you know, adopted the child and raised them, and everybody kind of knew except you. You were the, you know, that your mom is not really your mom type thing.
And you find out at Christmas.
Right.
When you're 12 years old.
When your uncle is drunk.
What you say, mom? Or auntie? What?
Yeah, it usually comes out in the fight.
When people get drunk.
But, you know, that's kind of that stereotypical thing that we see in the movies, that it comes out when someone's drunk and they're spilling all the tea of the family or something like that. And it comes out. And that somehow brings shame and stigma to that process of adoption. And I think that kind of continues that particular stigma that adoption is kind of like a bad thing. Otherwise, it wouldn't be so hush.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I'm saying? So let's talk about that. We're going to talk about the effects that it has on the family, the individual, the birth mother, all of those things. So definitely with that particular video, it definitely coincides with what we're talking about today. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of mental health issues stem from not knowing. Mm-hmm. And depression and anxiety are really high in those particular instances when you find out that you're adopted. So now you have this anxiety of like, oh wow, like, where did I come from? Who was my parent? What are they like? Am I similar to them? Am I resentful of her or my parents for not, you know, all of those things. So we're going to ask all those questions from a general perspective as well as from an individualized perspective here with Jackie and Miss Diane today. So you guys get a little glimpse in their thoughts today.
Lauren said she received the most scrutiny from black people when she placed her son for adoption.
Wow.
Thank you for saying that.
Yes.
Yeah, this is what I'm saying. This is the idea I have, and these are generalizations, are only my own opinion. I haven't been doing the factual research like you, but in my opinion, the way I've lived my life for 37 years, I feel like it's never discussed, and when it is brought up, there are so many questions raised that people are uncomfortable.
Yeah.
They want to avoid discomfort.
Right.
And so they don't want people asking, so they say nothing.
Right. Absolutely. So we're definitely going to talk about these things, address some myths, address some stigmas, the positives as well. We're going to definitely talk about the positives in regards to adoption, as well as some of the concerns or the negative standpoints that society has brought upon it. It's not necessarily what we've run upon, but overall as a collective, what we've brought on ourselves and how we think about that as far as, you know, adopting someone that you didn't biologically make, you know. But we'll definitely dive into that. So I definitely appreciate that trending topic. That was a really good video. If you haven't seen it, have you shared it?
I haven't shared it on my page. I'll share it on the couch page.
Yeah, we'll share that so we can
follow. The reunion video.
Yeah.
Great. And I think I'll share ours. I have that on video.
Oh, that's...
You okay with thousands of people saying that?
I know you are.
Yeah, I don't.
Answer quickly, Diane.
Yes.
Pretend you're okay.
I'm okay.
Wow.
I'm okay.
We'll talk about it later. Are you really okay with that? You can say it on the show.
It's fine.
Okay. We cuss on the show, too.
And you can share it on mine,
okay,
too.
You can cuss on the show, too.
Oh, no.
No. Not going to do that.
But we
encourage people to speak freely. So
if
you drop an F bomb or you say the S word or you know, it's okay. You know, we want you to be your authentic self.
And
we encourage people to live their truth on this show, you guys.
Okay.
So let's go ahead and get into this topic because we definitely have a lot of things that we're gonna try to cover within this hour.
And it's hot in here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's hot in here.
It's hot as hell in here. Diane has a fan.
This is the smartest thing ever. Can you order me one, please?
Yeah. $15.
She won't charge me.
Amazon. She's not going to charge me. Handheld fan. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Damien.
All right. So the first thing I definitely want to start off in our conversation today, and this is, again, for our college family as well as for our family that we have in the building as well. But I think I kind of touched on it initially. But why is there such a stigma associated with adoption?
I think...
Go ahead and answer, Diane.
Oh, you wait for us to ask you if you...
Okay. No, I'm just kidding. Go ahead.
Okay, so I think there's such a stigma with adoption because a lot of people don't tell that they're even pregnant. In my case, I didn't. And I kept it a secret for about 6 months. I hid my pregnancy. And I was really, really young. I had her when I was 16. And I got pregnant when I was 15.
Okay.
And it was away from my parents. My parents were kind of like in like a Christian cult.
Okay.
And
Diane's parents are white. She was raised by a white family.
I was
That's
raised
important.
By
she
a Caucasian family.
It's important for them to know the back history.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I hid my pregnancy, and I was living in Toronto at the time with my guardians and all the rest of the kids that were my same age. And when they found out, I was wearing really big clothes and stuff like that. Back in 82, I could do that. You know, all the kids were wearing big clothes. So I hid my pregnancy, and when my guardians found out, they sent me back to Chicago to my parents, and I had a belly. And my mom took me, she said, oh, you're really pregnant. And I said, well, yeah, I am, yeah. And she took me to the doctor, and the doctor said, well, you're gonna have a baby.
Mm-hmm.
And so my parents that were Caucasian wanted me to go to my grandmother's house and have the baby there just so that probably wouldn't
be away from
be
the family.
Seen within this place that I lived, this congregational place.
And was it more so because of they felt shame that you were pregnant?
I really don't know. I feel like with Caucasian people, that's what a lot of people were doing at the time. And I was not going to be able to care for her, but that had nothing to do with it.
That I was a black
baby?
Yeah,
that had nothing to do with
it. Oh, in my mind, that had everything to do with it.
No,
in my mind of minds.
No, it was, my parents were like, well, we're going to take you to this place that was a Salvation Army group home for young women. Some of these girls were like 14 years old having babies, and they were pregnant. And so I went in there, and they joined me up, they signed me up, and I stayed for 3 months, and I did summer school, and I did all kinds of activities, arts and crafts, all that stuff. And I stayed until I had the baby.
Mm-hmm.
And then everything changed for me because I had the baby. And when I saw her, I wanted to keep her.
Mm-hmm. And I called my mom and I begged her, please let me keep her. You know, I was like in tears and it was traumatic. Mm-hmm. It was really traumatic. Mm-hmm. And my mom said, no. No, we already decided what we're going to do. And so it was hard because I didn't have a say-so in the situation. And when they took me to court to sign the papers, the judge looked at me and said, no one's making you do this. Mm-hmm. Right?
Are they?
Are they? And I didn't say anything because my mom was there. And I just... It was a hard thing. I mean, I was really traumatized by it for the rest of my life. All those 35 years that I didn't have her, I was traumatized. It changed my whole life.
Right. And we're definitely going to dive into those psychological effects as a birth parent, you know, how it did affect you. But I definitely wanted to get Jackie's opinion and thoughts on why you feel like it's a stigma. Because even in her story, even Diane's story, it's the shame and the guilt as a parent of a child that was pregnant. Mm-hmm. It's a shame that comes over them, like, okay, we're bad parents that our child, you know, underage is having a child.
Okay.
So they're kind of putting their own feelings on that. So I wanted to get your perspective as to why you feel like there is, or do you feel like there's a stigma associated with it?
I do. I think a lot of that, I'm going to talk about my personal opinion, growing up as a child who's adopted from inside the family and then from outside, how I felt like things were brought up and how it was discussed. Mm-hmm. Inside the family, my parents were not trying to keep this a secret. They wanted us to know as soon as we were old enough, hey, this is who you are. We picked you out. You are special. You know, we picked you out of a mm-hmm. group of people.
Right.
And we were not able to do these things the way other people do them, so we went a different route. And I grew up, number one, being grateful for that explanation because it took all self-esteem issues about that from me. Mm-hmm. I didn't feel neglected or like somebody tossed me to the side. No, I felt picked out. I felt special. Now, when I got to school, this is part of the reason I feel parents that go through the process of wanting to adopt kids, they really go through these discussions about whether they're going to tell them or not because they don't want them to be treated badly. And I remember coming home to my mother and an individual who I went to grammar school with who shall forever remain nameless to people who don't know what happened firsthand. But I remember her telling me, you can take your adopted self back from where you came from. You don't even have a real family. And when you're hearing that, when you're 8 years old, 9 years old, I remember one of the coaches at the school that I went to heard it. And she was adopted. Mm. And that coach jumped on the bandwagon of, let me tell you something. And the girl was punished. You know, she had some kind of consequence.
Right.
And then I was spent the rest of the day sobbing in the coach's office, not wanting to be seen. Oh, I don't have a real family. I mean, you know, when you get old enough, you realize, wait, I do have a real family.
Right.
But children are so cruel that you don't want to grow up answering questions that you don't have answers for.
Right.
And so you don't want to say shit about it. You don't want anybody asking and poking. You have no answers.
And that, I guess that's the, the thing that you don't have.
You
the
don't
answers.
Know anything.
So,
and I was adopted too.
Wow.
Yeah. So I can relate
it's in the
to
bloodline.
That. But I wanted her with a black family because me being raised by Caucasian white parents, I missed out on a lot of my culture, heritage, everything.
Right.
And I didn't want that for her.
Right. And that was going to actually, I'm glad you brought that up because that was going to be my next question. And you guys definitely comment, you know, my college family out there, but I definitely want to discuss the example that you did gave coming from a Caucasian family. You didn't want Jackie or even yourself to kind of miss out on the cultural norms of an African-American family. So do you feel like... And I'll take this from a grand scale as well because we see it pretty often, whether that's Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie, they have, you know, a multitude of adoptions and most of them are
multitude.
Like, you know, they're from Africa or they're from some, you know,
Thailand.
Yeah.
Whatever.
You know, so what are your thoughts on, and we call that transadoptional or adoption, trans adoptions across cultures. What do you feel about that? Do you feel like blacks should only adopt black? or you should go to black or white, you know, that type of thing. What do you guys feel about that?
Diane?
It's always coming to you first.
Wow, that's a hard one. For me,
I'm not gonna give an answer either way. So I'll answer first if you want to think about what you want to say.
Mm-hmm. That'd be great.
I don't place a judgment on that. There are so many kids that need homes. Yes. Why yes. be picky about every damn thing? Mm-hmm. You either want them to have a home or you don't.
Right.
And so I understand her personal notion of, this is my child, I have a motherly bond with that child, and this is what I want to select for this child to grow up in. I understand that that's instinctual. That's an innate desire,
mm-hmm.
and that burns from somewhere. However, I don't place a judgment on families mixing adoption, you know, when they're mixing races and adoption. I'm not going to say, wait a minute right there, unless I'm, like, prepared to take mm-hmm. that kid.
Right.
Even if you are, it's still not a healthy situation. So I don't place judgment on that. Yeah,
so do you feel like, as an adoptive parent, let's say if I adopted a Caucasian child, do you feel like it's my duty to ensure that that child is aware of their own culture, cultural norms, you know, things that quote-unquote white people would do?
Yes.
Mm. Okay.
Why is that? Very much so. Because I never had any of that.
Okay.
You know, not that they didn't think it was important, but I was living in a congregational setting all the time with groups of kids my age
right.
and all that. And we were moving every year. And it was, I felt like, why did you adopt me if you were going to do this to
mm-hmm.
me?
Mm-hmm.
Because I was so lost of who I was.
Right.
I didn't even know I was adopted till I was like 9 years old and came back home from school being teased. I didn't know.
Oh, they didn't tell you.
They didn't
you.
Tell me. They never told
me. Oh,
they didn't
that was
tell
a different
me
approach.
Until mm-hmm. I was nine.
Right.
And then my mom said, you're a very special child. And then I was like, what?
She came in too late with that, huh?
I was very special, huh?
Yeah.
So special
yeah.
you couldn't tell me why I was
right.
I was like,
Right.
But, I mean, I didn't. I do have a brother that had red hair. I had a brother that had brown hair. And then I had a brother that was blonde. And then there was me.
Mm-hmm.
But my hair was not like this when I was little. It was much.
This is hilarious.
I didn't think I was anything different.
You know why this is funny to me? Because she's talking about a whole different race, but I grew up with the same identity issues, and I was raised in a black damn family.
Mm-hmm.
And this is why I wanted to talk about this, because mm-hmm. as I expressed to you before the show, growing up, my issue was, I don't even look like the black kids in my house.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah.
You know, this didn't get big till I went to college.
Okay.
And then going to Bennett, and being down at A&T, you know, black school,
yeah.
I'm walking around campus like, oh, you know, I'm a little cute. And people are like, what do you mix with? What do you mix with? I'm like, what do you think I mix with?
Right.
Black and black. And I'm saying this like for 20 years, and I'm just telling people this in the back of my mind. It's hurting me because I don't know the real answers. And I was joking with you before the show, but I was dead ass serious that when the Ethiopian stopped me in DC airport, I was like, okay, I'll be Ethiopian.
Right.
Give me my sandwich. Because they give me free food. And so they think I'm one of them, their tribe. So they're like, look, you can have this. And they don't even speak to me. They just hand me food.
Right.
So I was like, okay, I like that hospitality.
Mm-hmm.
I meet Ethiopians. I meet black Puerto Ricans.
Yeah.
They think I'm Puerto Rican. They start talking to me in Spanish.
Or
I'm
Dominican.
Sure you could get the same thing when you
Dominican,
went to San Juan.
Puerto
Rican.
Yeah, I've gotten all of that and was wondering. And by the time I met her, I was just praying. That there was no white there. But unfortunately for me, I was wrong, and there is. And that's why I'm so this.
A lot of white.
You know?
So,
a lot of white girl.
And I told you before the show that you dance like a white girl when you
and
twerk.
And that's okay. That's okay.
She twerks
okay
like
that.
A white girl.
Okay. I'm okay with that, actually.
As long as you're okay with it, everybody
I don't need everyone
else
knowing any real skills that I have, so.
Oh.
We can move right along with the mama bear
okay
sitting in the middle of us.
Yeah, we can, yeah. So, I guess another question that
mm-hmm.
popped up for me, definitely, and you guys definitely add in, comment, let us know your thoughts as well. But when When a child is adopted, when is a good time to tell that child that they're adopted?
I think as soon as you can.
As soon as they can comprehend. Yeah. I was 5. I was handed my birth certificate. Sit at the table. Let's have a round table. This is who you are. We got this from this place. You know, and I appreciated it. And every year, they, from my knowledge, every year they gave it to us and we sat around again and reviewed it. It was almost like their way of jogging memory, like, look, just so you know, we love you dearly, but this is where you came from.
Right.
To make sure it was instilled in us.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
I like that approach.
I didn't get that.
Like, we went to the grocery store and we pick out what we want. We picked you out. My dad had a good line. And I held on to that. I went to college like, they picked us out.
But like also, even in that, like, your perspective is one way because you were, you accepted it and you got the information early. So you were kind of trained in that.
Yes.
But people that haven't had that opportunity or was sprung on them, you know, the thoughts that they have that kind of continues to perpetuate that stigma is that I was picked out. I was chosen, but they look at it as a negative thing. Like someone had to come and pick me because nobody else wanted me or the people that birthed me didn't want me. So, you know, this person just came over here and saw what I looked like in the mirror and kind of grabbed me.
I didn't think like that until I was much older because then the questions start because your brain really grabs a hold of you're not with the people you started out with.
Right.
And so that's like, well, what happened? And so that was after 15. But while I was a kid, I'm telling you, like, my deep-rooted sense of esteem comes from the idea of me walking around the playground and telling people, your mother was stuck with you. I got picked out. Your mother had you and got stuck with you. And so my retaliation was, let me tell you about me. My parents was up in a place where there was a bunch of kids. They just my size. They looked just like me, but I was the cutest. And they picked, and I just hung on to that. And I loved saying that. And it made me feel good. Okay. And it was what they instilled in me.
Right. So it all comes back to how the parents presented
relays the information.
Yes, absolutely. Because most of our families is like, oh, yeah, you were adopted. You know.
Yeah.
And it's, again, it's probably at a Christmas function or Thanksgiving, and they've eaten all the food, and they started drinking. Start
like,
drinking
what?
And stuff.
What'd
yeah.
you say? Under your breath?
Like your aunt is really your mom. You know, they have that on like every Madea
I'm not
movie.
A part of this family anyway. What?
Yeah. That's why you guys treated me differently.
That's why we picked you up on 75th Street when you were out there in the cold by yourself. What? What? What did you say?
That's so why anyway. Your aunt left you on
right,
the doorstep.
Right, right.
You know, that type of thing. So, hopefully that didn't happen to anyone that's watching.
I hope not either.
Because it's not funny.
No, it's not.
But it's just the way that we're presenting
it. We have
right
to
now.
Use humor right now
yes,
to carry through the moment.
Absolutely.
Yeah, go ahead, Damion. I know you got a whole schedule. Stuff.
So I definitely wanted to, again, our title is Psychological Impact of Adoption for the Parent, the Birth Parent, as well as the Child, because we have both of them in studio here. We got Miss Diane, and we got Jaquella, Jackie. I'll wait for you to look up.
I know you won't. Stop triggering me.
So I definitely wanted to talk general as well as, again, individualized in your experiences on the effects that it had on you. For one, Diane, you know, making that choice to, quote-unquote, choice, because it really, your story seems like it wasn't really a choice. It was like you had to
it
do it.
It wasn't a choice for me.
But also, for you, Jackie, as far as, you know, how did you feel once you learned that you were adopted? You know, so I wanted to kind of just pitch that out there. And you guys, if you experienced this as well, I love the comments. I love the conversation that we have going on right now.
And everybody's sharing it.
Yeah,
thank you for sharing this.
Thank you for sharing.
We need to spread this a little bit more.
Yeah, absolutely.
We do. Okay.
And you might want to find out if you're adopted or not. I always thought I was.
We're going to get, I think we should get into that too.
Because my sisters are light skinned. And I'm the only dark one. And I was kind of different. I've always been weird.
That's part of my deep-rooted issue, so I don't want you to trigger me. I just revealed this. Did you see? I felt my eyes cutting at you so hard, like, really? Yeah. I'm going to say this before you... Let me make something a little lighter before you get straight into that question.
Okay.
Oh, okay. You want to get straight into the question?
No,
I'll bring it up later. I'm not going to forget. Go ahead, Diane. Talk about that.
Talk about
See?
Okay, I want to say this, that I was really struck on television watching shows cringing for the joke about adoption to come up. Mm. I was so affected by that, watching Fresh Prince of Bel-Air and them joking with Carlton about being adopted and which one was the adopted kid. Right. And Nikki came in looking different and he was a baby all of a sudden. They joked, oh, we adopted this kid from where? I mean, it was a joke. It's always a joke. Ha ha ha. And so I feel like what we take in, okay, what we expose our children to shapes their brains for how they're going to look at things. Yeah. And I was always embarrassed hearing jokes about adoption on television. I thought it was the shittiest thing to make fun of.
Right.
And I've always felt a way about that. Mm. I don't like when I'm with friends and they're with their family and they're all joking at the table at the holiday about who's adopted, knowing none of them are adopted. Yeah. It's not a joke to me. It's my life. And I really try not to take it personal, but it's a soft thing for me. Mm-hmm. A very soft thing.
I appreciate you sharing that.
Yeah.
So I won't utilize that joke anymore, you guys.
Thank you, Jamie.
Well, at least not around.
I don't think it's funny.
That was true. This is what it is.
I was going to compliment you for your sensitivity, but I still will. Thanks.
I mean, you can do it.
Please use discretion around me.
Yeah, the first part. You know.
Okay.
That's just, I'll be mindful.
Not around her.
Okay. Yeah, I'll
appreciate
just be mindful.
That. And thank that's you. It. That's
I'm
all.
Just, I'm just being honest.
Okay. You can go back to your
question. So again, psychological effects of you, Diane, as far as like, how did you feel emotionally during that time span? And even over a time span of 35 years, like, how do you feel like it's affected you and shaped you?
It's really affected me. I just felt like somebody cut my arm off and I was always looking for my arm. It's a piece of you. And it's a piece of you that changes everything in your life. It changes how you feel about having any more children. It's I waited
10 years
exactly and 11 days to have another child. I have a son. And
shout out to Keelan.
Keyron. But
my bio brother.
Yeah, he is. But when I was young, I got into a lot of trouble. I was promiscuous. I was lost. I went into therapy when I was young, and then it just kind of stopped. So I was really kind of fucked up for the rest of my life, even in my marriage now, even with my friends. Everything just stops in your mind because you're constantly thinking of this.
Oh, you're fixated at that
you're
moment.
You're fixated all the time. You see, most of my friends had little girls.
Right.
So it would be so rough for me. They wouldn't have like one little girl. They'd have like two and three.
You'd be like, God damn it, where'd you get those kids?
So I'd be like, it is the hardest thing to be around someone who has the same sex that your daughter is, and you know she's out there. And it, and then like every birthday or every Mother's Day, I used to sit in the backyard and cry and just sit by myself and be like, oh my God, it's her whatever birthday.
Right.
Oh my God, you know, when is this going to happen for me? You know, and I pray and I do everything. And it just, everything in my life until the day I met her was messed up or fucked up, you know, everything that I did, you know, because I only had two children because I feel like God gifted me two. And I knew, I just saw a psychic when I was like 20 years old and she was like, oh, she's going to, your daughter, you're going to, I know you have a daughter. And I didn't say anything to her. And she was like, well, she's going to be really well educated. And
shout out to the psychic.
Yeah, shout out to the psychic.
Shout out to the psychic.
Because it really gave me hope, you know.
Right.
But anyway. She was right.
We don't know sometimes.
She is very well. What else did she say about me?
Oh, she said that.
Complimentary things only, please.
She said that she's just going to be really, really well educated. She's going to be well put together. And you're going to meet her. And I was like, what? So then I went on that for 35 years, you know. No, for the next 15 years, you know. And I thought, oh, okay. And then I just thought one day, okay, I'm going to be like 70 before I meet her.
you know.
So let me ask this question. Who was the first to kind of like make contact? Was it yourself or was it Jackie?
It was Jackie. And I thought that it was a person I had,
Diane was so
I interviewed for a long lost family for 2 years mm-hmm. and they denied my story. And so my heart on TLC. Yeah. And so my heart was with that.
But they took her through the process.
Yeah, they took
for like
me,
over a year.
They interviewed.
Like they were going to help her to find me. So that's trauma.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay, when you're already dealing with it's trauma on top of trauma on top of trauma. Right. Like promising her they were going to help her.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So then my heart broke because I was like, okay, I'm going to give that a rest. Because I can't deal with that now. That's a lot.
Wrong one. Yeah.
And so she reached out to me. And you know, I'm not a... You know, I'm 53, so I'm not kind of like into looking at pictures of people and all that. So I saw
her
name.
Ass down on Facebook.
I saw her name in my messages and her phone number.
I sent you a message asking you what? If you had been on adopted.com, do you remember?
Yeah, yeah.
And you were like, yeah, why?
Because I'm like... Because I went to everything.
But
after
I don't think she's looking at my face like the profile photo of the person who messaged me.
I really didn't.
I'm like, does this woman not see my face?
This is a person trying to get money from me.
Yeah, she kind of treated me like I wanted something
from her. Because I talk to people that search for their biological Skeptical children or whatever. And so I called and, and my heart was telling me, just give it a minute, you know. Mm-hmm. Let me process this. Right. And then I thought, no, this really can't be.
And what did I say to you? What's the next thing I said to you?
I don't remember.
I remember. I said, I asked you if you, I told you I found your name there. Mm-hmm. And that I wanted, you should call me as soon as possible. And then she did.
And then an hour later, I felt like, fuck it. I'm going for it. Mm-hmm. I'm diving in. And so I called her and we had questions for each other, but... The question that I had was, where were you born?
I said, in Chicago, and your name is on my birth certificate.
No, she said, this is the one thing that I knew she would be my daughter. She said, at the Salvation Army group home.
Oh, yeah, that's on my birth certificate, too.
So, that was the thing, and I just screamed.
You screamed.
And I was running up and down
my
hallway.
You're my daughter. You're my daughter. Oh, my God. And she was like, wait, are you driving? You should pull over. And I said, hell no. I'm at work.
Do you guys see this right now?
I gotta go to work. I can't pull over.
I felt like anointed for like 5-6 months. I mean, it was an energy that God gifted me this thing.
Yeah.
And
it was definitely the healing moment. It's kind of like you go through this grief process to only find out that the person really isn't dead. Yeah. And it's kind of like you have that sense of relief and like just overwhelming feeling of love and.
Well, I came at her with the only detail I really knew most of my life because someone had told it to me through the grapevine, which is my birth father was from Trinidad. And so I remember telling her on the birth certificate, my birth father, and she goes, is from Trinidad. And I was like, that's when I almost crashed my car because most of it is just knowledge and just random information until you solidify something that touches you deeper.
Right. And so, he was... half Chinese.
All right, thanks, Diane. She's outed me nationality-wise. There's a lot
she's
going on
all
there.
Over the place.
And I appreciate that. Okay, fine.
Everywhere.
So, okay, my birth father is black and Chinese. He shall remain nameless. And so, because that's where he is right now, nameless. And so this is the piece I have. And so this missing piece is the most important in my life. And so Diane is biracial, black, and white. So, black, white, and Chinese. This is why Karan looks like Tiger Woods. My son looks like a little Blasian. The eyes skip me, but they went down to him.
Know that?
Yeah, hell no. But when Boogie came out, let me tell you, baby, I told his father when he came out the womb, I said, they mixed him with an Asian baby. They mixed our baby. And I was on drugs, the epidural. And I was yelling it down the hall. They mixed up the baby. He's Asian. Yeah, but I knew. But that just means instinctually. And then Courtney's like, shh, don't like stir up the staff. They're trying to help us. Don't accuse the staff of stealing the baby.
Wow.
And I did. I accused them of mixing up the baby because I'm like, this child looks Asian.
And my son, too, because I lost all my pigment. And he came out like an Indian.
Yeah. Was dark. And the nurse said, I don't think this one's yours.
What a horrible thing.
And she...
Wow.
Yeah, so there it is. So I'm all mixed up, but I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
Okay.
I did the same thing when my kids were born.
What did somebody tell me?
They were light skinned. And I was like,
wait a minute.
Somebody told me, that's why you're so short. I was like, oh, that you was funny. Maybe that is why I'm so short.
Wow.
Moving along.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I reached out to her.
Okay.
But I want to make it clear that I wasn't in this search my whole life in turmoil mentally of I have to find. And I had to explain to Diane many times that I'm coming from a different mental space, which was my needs were met.
Right.
So when your needs are really met in most ways growing up, you're not as upset about it and angry. I was way more accepting of, you know what, God blessed me with this family because this person had me put here, and so that's okay. So I wasn't so much angry by the time I met her.
Right.
I was just like, oh, okay, this makes sense. Now I have questions.
She had questions.
But I wasn't angry.
Which is, I guess, maybe not the norm. Like,
not to be angry?
Yeah, like, for most situations, the child that was adopted, they often have some type of resentment. There's some type of psychological effect of that, whether that's anxiety, depression, just behavioral issues growing up.
Yeah.
You know, just because you're confused, you don't know, you know, and these things, you just feel different.
You do.
Now, I'm not adopted, but I'm just saying, I'm just going off of other people's experiences right now, you guys. But I definitely want to kind of talk about relationship-wise, like, what's important in establishing healthy boundaries? Once you do meet each other, you guys do connect, how do you establish those boundaries? What does the relationship look like in regards to birth parent versus adoptive parent? You know, how do those things look? I mean, you guys can speak from personal experience, but overall, and you guys can comment as well, like, how does that normally look?
It's a slow process, and you're always, my family was telling me, my brothers were telling me, it's not about you.
Mm.
It's not about you.
Oh, they tell you that?
They told me that.
So
I'll
stop telling her that.
Because I have to respect her feelings.
Mm-hmm.
I have to respect her family.
Right.
I have to respect her mother and father. I have to respect her community of friends.
Right.
I have to respect her son, and those feelings that they have.
Hmm.
And it goes through my head every time I say something or something comes out of my mouth.
That's because I have, Damien's laughing because he knows me, but that's because I think we have different personalities, but I have a lot of pieces of her in my personality.
Yeah,
okay.
I definitely see that.
All right, Damien, whatever. So Damien's taking jabs. I think it's me. Diane has nothing to do with you. Okay. This is personal between me and him. It's a constant thing we got going on. You watch the show, so you know. So anyway, I have pieces of Diane and me, and the pieces of her and me, they really come to the rescue when the growing up pieces of me overtake it. So growing up, I was, you know, more domineering personality, but she is more subtle and stand back when you bring something to her attention. I don't feel like I was raised that way. I was raised, let them know your opinion, you know, keep boundaries. People just have to respect it. I don't care who it is.
Right.
And so that was my first approach with her. I think the hardest thing was when you wouldn't call me by my name. And
it was
in
really
the first
hard.
Like 6 months,
really
she would
hard.
Be like, sweetie, beautiful.
I didn't know.
Listen.
What's it say?
Okay, you're talking over me now.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Like I talk over David on the show. Now you know how hard it is. So basically, she never called me by my name. And I realized at some point I was driving and I started to get, the anger starts in certain situations.
Mm-hmm.
It was making me angry. It's her fault that I'm here. It's her fault that we're like this. Why won't she respect me enough to call me by my name? But I told you that every time I would tell you, Diane, it feels weird that we're spending all this time together and I've known you 6 months and you won't say my name. And she just sat there and was like, I gave you a different name. Like I had given you a different name.
It was hard. It was just hard. It was hard.
So
I did. I like when I would text her. I would text her like three times
hey,
and
beautiful.
Erase it.
Hey, beautiful.
And then I just didn't know what was proper. Yeah. I didn't know what to say to her. Mm-hmm. I loved her so much, and I had her in my heart all that time. I didn't know how to communicate with her. I just didn't.
Okay, and so it was hard for me to relate to that because I try to tell Diane, I didn't feel like I had such a piece that was missing. Remember, she had the leg or arm cut off. Right. I didn't have a leg cut off. I had all my legs, you know what I'm saying? I was adopted at under 3 months.
Right. Yeah.
So if all you know, when I'm learning the talk, I'm learning with these people, I don't have a limb to lose. And so that's how I try to explain it. It's not about not caring about you. You know, I have love for you. I do. I mean, I love you. I don't tell you that because I feel like you will. I mean, I do. I just haven't allowed myself to express that, but I do love you. But I feel like I can't tell you that because you're so sensitive. You're more sensitive than me. And I don't want you to cling to it so hard that when I'm direct with you, your feelings are hurt. It's like I'm a parent sometimes. I feel like the minute I tell this woman I love her, I can't discipline her no more. I can't tell her about boundaries. I feel like I can't hold you accountable for boundaries once I tell you that. So when you're like, I love you, and I'll be like, mm-hmm, me too. Uh-huh. Yeah. You know, yep, I feel the same way. Yep, goodbye. I mean, that's what I do to her.
It's very rare that I say that because I know she's so...
I don't like to hear it.
What is it about hearing that makes you emotional, that makes you clam up to... And we're kind of almost getting off topic, but
no,
we're going to make it go.
This is natural.
Yeah, it's good.
Because, like I said, I didn't lose a limb. I feel it's a betrayal to my mother.
Mm.
Evelyn raised me. Evelyn is my mother. And I know Diane understands that because she has an adopted mother who is her mother. Right. That's your mama. Somebody says something about her, that's your mama. Whether you meet your birth mother today or tomorrow, whatever, Evelyn is my mother. She gave her life to raise multiple children, you know, took them in to care for them, and they didn't come from her.
Right.
And I feel a sense of loyalty towards that, I might be breaking. So I have always felt uncomfortable. Diane, let me finish. I've always felt uncomfortable placing that feeling with her because in my mind, this isn't derogatory towards you, but in the mind of someone who's adopted, I feel like she hasn't earned me to express that the way my mother has yet.
Right.
I mean, she's been there 37 years. I mean, something to be said for that.
Right.
I've known Diane 2 years. So it's also my way of protecting myself. What if I lose contact with her again? I remember when we first met, this is so vital, when we first met at the hotel, and then you were leaving. And when you was leaving, you gave me your bracelets off your arm. And I broke down like a 5-year-old. And I was repeating, don't leave me. Don't leave me. You know, don't leave me again.
Right.
And she was like, I'll never leave you. I'll never leave you.
I told her I was here.
And so I had not anticipated feeling like that. I was basically standoffish to her the whole visit. I wasn't mean, but I was so protected and boundary aware that I was like, I will not tell this woman who came out of nowhere who gave me away that I love her. I won't do it.
Right.
And so a lot of that was pride and ego. And it just came out.
I knew she had that wall up. I knew she did. So I just kind of like just loved her and told her, I'm here for you.
Right.
I'm here. From now on, I'm here.
And
I'm not going anywhere.
And I think that's the biggest struggle is finding that fine line of boundaries, you know, within the relationship and honoring, you know, your mother versus saying, okay, you carried me for 9 months and we have this physiological and biological connection that can't be broken as well. So it's not a slight on either side. And I think it's really tough for a child that's been adopted that has relationships on both ends to equally say, okay, I'm just going to be love and feel love from both ends. It's not a slight on anyone. You didn't have control over the situation, but you also still have this connection, you know, and putting that wall up, it was just a self-defense mechanism.
It's still up a little bit.
Yeah, of course.
And then I have a kid now, so I want to be a good mom too.
Yeah.
But when people question, beside the special needs that Karan has, if you think about it, he's the first relative I've known who's blood related.
Right.
So when people want to make comments about my attachment to him, I'm okay with that.
Right.
I'm attached at the hip to him. I'm going to have to deal with that continuously through therapy.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't want the child. I used to not want him out of my sight. And it had more to do with he's what I have.
And so when I met Diane and we looked alike and we had the same smile, I was awestruck by it. And sometimes I pushed away from her just because she was too much like me. Like, she gets into these modes, God love her, where she's like, oh, I do that. Oh, you're so much like me. You got that from me. And I'm like, I don't like even want to acknowledge it. Like,
Wow.
You know, because I'm defensive about it, but I own that. I don't. Yeah. Nobody knows what it's like unless you're in it.
Right.
It's hard to go through that and have somebody telling you all the time, just like me, just like me. You almost get angry sometimes.
Yeah.
Like, Jesus, if you were that clingy to me,
why'd
you let me go?
Right.
I mean, but that's
right.
not realistic
yeah.
and it's not logical.
Yeah.
I know why. So I have to go back and forth with that. I go back and forth.
So I guess we a little bit over, but it's
okay.
That's okay.
They don't care.
But we're going to definitely continue this conversation, but I also want to kind of address the relationships that you guys have developed over time. How is it with birth mother versus adoptive mother, that they set up certain parameters early on? Like, you know, or did you do that since you were older when you met her?
I set it up when I met her. I mean, we had to have multiple conversations because this is not a over dinner conversation. This
right.
has gone on for almost 2 years. So February would be 2 years that I've known her. So I feel like we have a talk every time we're together.
Mm-hmm.
And because I want to be sensitive to her emotional reaction,
right.
but then make her aware of who I am. And I tell you all the time, what? I do not get excited easily. I will not say I'm excited to see you. And it's not about you. It's about, I don't use that word. I've had friends tell me I never say that.
Mm.
Even about being on the news, I may have said it once or twice. I don't know, but I
right.
tell her, I try to prep her. This
right.
is who I am. Communicate with her so
yes.
that she's not like, damn, my daughter, she mean as hell. I mean, I'm trying to say, hey, these are my parameters, and I wasn't raised by a mother who was mushy. She was more like, protect yourself.
And I am.
Protect. Mm. Oh, yeah. Diane, real mushy.
Oh, yeah.
So I tell my friends, I'm like, whoa, Diane, sensitive. My friend's like, oh, just like you.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, I don't really, you know, whatever. So.
You're very mushy. Yeah. When you want to be.
Okay,
know,
okay. We have the Oh, we have the same
okay.
laugh, too.
Sorry.
We're
going
to cut
wow.
that off. All right,
this is scary, you guys, to sit in the studio and hear an echo of Jackie. Already
okay.
enough.
All right.
Time.
All right.
Two hours.
So yeah, but I had to set up the boundaries, and there were many calls. There were a couple calls I made to my mom, like when Evelyn told me, hey, my mom told me, I don't care to be involved in these ways, but I want you to be happy and have your life, and this is what I want mine
mm-hmm.
to look at. That's respect for her boundaries,
right.
and
right.
I had to tell Diane that she didn't necessarily like that at first, but
mm-hmm.
she understands.
I respect it
because we have to,
yeah,
and
have to.
Just like I have to respect how you feel about wanting to do certain things for me. My biggest thing, Diane was giving me gifts a lot. I feel like in the first 6 months, and I remember one argument we had ended in tears for both of us, where I was like, you have to stop. And she was like, no. And she was like, you listen. I was like, you listen. And we were going back and forth. You listen, you listen, you listen. And I was like, these gifts are too much because I wasn't raised
mm-hmm.
giving random gifts and receiving them.
Mm-hmm.
I was raised a holiday, your birthday, you get gifts. So when she was giving them, I wasn't thinking she needs to do this because she's missed so much. I was
right.
thinking, yeah, this is overwhelming. I'm
right.
not ready for this type of care and concern for
yeah.
you.
Yeah, that
yeah.
type
well,
of relationship.
Yeah. I felt like I hadn't had my daughter. I can do whatever the hell I want to do.
Mm.
And you gonna just take it. You know.
Oh, this is the first time this is coming out. I see now that she's on the couch.
Because
she's all aggressive.
Just,
she does not talk
like
this when
ding.
We're not on the couch.
You know, I just felt like I never had that
mm-hmm.
with my daughter.
Right.
So,
right. There you go.
You know.
Okay.
And I watched my friends do it. And then when I had the opportunity to do it, hell yeah, I'm going to do it.
He'd be like, it's your birthday. I'm going to see you. It's 3 months before Christmas, but I'm going to give it to you. And I'm going to give it to you now because I won't see you then.
And it's Mother's Day.
Yeah, yeah. It's Mother's Day. Take this necklace. Take it. Take it.
Oh, my God.
Pandora, Michael Kors, Tiffany.
Wow.
I kind of like that. There was somebody asked me, then why do you take it if you don't want it? And I'm like, it's jewelry. You stop judging me. It's jewelry,
so,
damn it. I told her I didn't want it, but I had to take it.
So my last and final question, we'll be getting out of here, you guys. This has definitely been an awesome conversation. Definitely going to have to piggyback on this, you know, in the future for sure. a little tear jerk, a little bit of laughing. It's all good. That's what we do on the couch. We express. We're emotional.
Because our mental health matters.
Mental health matters.
It really does.
Purge it out. So, adding to that, what would you guys say for, one, for parents that are on the fence of, you know, giving their child up for adoption? You know, from your perspective, you know, what's your thoughts? What's your feelings? You know, what should they look for? And Jackie, on your end, being a child that has been adopted, you know, what are some final thoughts for our family out there that has been adopted and kind of struggling with it from a mental health standpoint? What would you say as well? So I'm going to let y'all have the floor.
My feelings are every family is different.
Mm-hmm.
Every family is different. I also feel like the respect is really important.
Okay.
And however they're going to adopt,
mm-hmm.
Just have a lot of love and understand that they need that culture and they need whatever that child is. They need that
mm-hmm.
for the rest of their lives. And look into it and study it and, you know.
No. I think just to add to that, for the parents that are thinking about giving up for adoption, giving their child up for adoption, doesn't necessarily mean that you're a bad parent, that you're on drugs, that you're a crackhead, that something bad's happened, you know, and you have to give the child up. It doesn't make you a bad person, because I think a lot of parents that I've experienced that have given children up for adoption, they often suffer with depression,
mm-hmm.
you know, from that guilt. You know, I'm a bad person, I'm a bad parent.
It's traumatic.
Yeah. Jackie?
I forgot the question for me.
What are some final words that you would want to say to someone that has been adopted, that's been struggling with this emotionally? From an anxiety standpoint, self-esteem,
like the not knowing and the questions.
Yeah.
Go see a therapist. Thank you, Jackie. You see what I'm talking about?
Jackie, you do it every week. So now you're feeling
I know,
it.
But it's
and it's not weird coming from me.
Somebody's acting great the way I do.
That laugh. Oh my God, you guys.
Oh.
Wow.
All right, listen.
Sorry.
That's okay. So anyway, the way I feel is if you're struggling with it, number one, go see a therapist. Number two, do not convince yourself that you don't want to know and that you don't care. That's what I did. I totally suppressed that for 30-something years, at least 20 of them, a good 20 of them. I gave speeches in college like I was the most confident adopted person, and I really wasn't. And I appreciate a friend of mine, Rachel Crouch, actually, really pushed me to digging deeper. And mm-hmm. then, you know, people
I've
been
cry.
She likes Rachel. She loves Rachel. But I had friends too that had, and people I was in relationships with over years that were like, do you want to do this? And people I grew up with, and I'd say, no, like, leave me alone. I don't want to talk about it. And I was in a situation 2 years ago, right before I met her, where I was in a car and I was telling the friend of mine in the car that I didn't want to know. And that person was really pushing me. And I started yelling and hollering, I don't want to know. I don't want to know. And it turned into tears. And when I realized that that had turned into anger and mm-hmm. venom spewing
right.
at this person,
absolutely.
I'm like, holy crap. I guess I have awakened something that I didn't realize was
right.
in me, which
right.
was the desire. And
yeah.
so I say that if you want to know, if any parts of you want to know, you need to file the paperwork. It took me 3 weeks and $10 to get my birth certificate. And I was stunned when it came in the mail with all the information on it. Her whole name, and that's how I found her. I have a friend that I will not reveal. Shout out to What's-His-Face from Chicago, who works for a credit bureau, who looked up her information illegally to help me find her. Shout out to you. He knows who he is. He's watching. I love you, boo. Yeah, he's like, oh, you know I work for these people. What's her name? And
wow,
so
I get that.
He's the one that told me to look on adoption.com.
Uh-huh.
And I've known his family my whole life. And he said if she ever wanted to find you, she would have put on a profile. He gave me 3 or 4 adoption websites.
Yeah.
And her name was one of 7. And I started looking. And I this is funny because I started looking
funny.
On Facebook. And I saw this face. I had called like 3 white people. And I could tell they were white on the phone. And I was like, no. My birth mother's not white. It can't be. I had just seen Black Panther.
I had just seen Black Panther and I was like, no, that's not even in the cards for me. It's like some Somalian, Ethiopian, Dominican situation. Like, it can't be. And so I saw her photo and I was like, she looked fair skinned. Wait a minute, her face looked like my face. God damn, her face looked like my face. I said, well, that's my face. Oh, somebody older. Shit. I said, that's her. But she looked half white. That might be a problem, but I'm still gonna contact her. Yeah, and I told her.
She said,
I didn't want you to be white.
She said, are you white?
Yeah, I said it. I did say it, okay? Because I was raised by a Black family. That was my whole identity that I knew.
Yeah.
So it doesn't seem I got white friends and white people in my family, but it didn't matter. That's what I identified with. That's all I had.
Right.
So I told her straight up, I ain't want you to be white. But now I understand
why I do a lot of stuff I do.
I got a lot of the Golden Girls mannerisms. And I'm okay with that. And the white twerk that you was talking about, whatever you want to call it.
White twerk.
I'm okay with that. I'm going to own it.
Oh my goodness.
Well, we had to end
that. And I like Chinese food.
We had to end that on a hilarious, funny moment.
Yes, we did.
Yeah, for sure. You guys. So, again, our topic today, psychological
like my spring rolls.
Effects of adoption for the birth parent and the child. This was an awesome discussion. I definitely appreciate Ms. Diane for coming into the show today.
I loved it.
We appreciate it. I'm pretty sure she appreciates it because she's the one that came up with the idea.
Yes, I appreciate Diane. I love you, Diane. I
love you.
I know I don't say it ever.
That's okay.
It's hard for me, even though I'm expressive. I just need you to understand that. And it's hard to sit in my seat with
it. She's being emotional.
Yeah, I understand it.
Yeah, it's hard for me because I'm still protecting myself a little bit.
Mm-hmm. A lot.
Of course. Mm-hmm. But we're going to have to work on those barriers.
Diane's taking jabs. Diane's talking about a lot.
We're going to have to work on those obstacles and those barriers.
Diane's taking jabs.
Because we need to get Jackie down here. We need to get that. Yeah, mm-hmm. We can't have the guarded Jackie.
That takes time.
Yeah.
As you know in the therapeutic process, Mr. Counselor.
It takes time. Mm-hmm. We're going to work
adjustments don't take place overnight or over a year and a half.
Okay.
Yeah, it'll happen if you want it to happen. Hey, but to close this out, anything going on, Ms. Jack? You got any events popping up?
Well, first of all,
yeah.
We didn't talk about me being on Fox News.
Hello.
This week.
Hello.
Yeah,
I was on Fox News for the third time.
We appreciate the shout out, the plug for the
couch. Oh, yeah, we talked up the couch
on
Fox 46.
That.
I'm excited about that.
Yeah.
Thank you. She's excited, too. She was there. She was... All those nice photos and video footage you saw, Diane took that.
Courtesy.
Thank you.
Yeah.
She was right in the newsroom with me, so that was fun.
Yeah.
And Boogie was in the green room, so that was exciting.
Right.
So, as far as coming up, I don't have anything coming up yet. In the next couple weeks, I'll have an announcement to make, but I'm waiting on that.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
You?
A big announcement.
Wait, you went to... What school did you go to?
I was at Winston-Salem State. That's like my second... college family almost now.
And you spoke about what?
Had a great conversation with the police officers up there about self-care, work-life balance. Phenomenal time, awesome people. We had great conversation, great dialogue with the police officers up there and allowing them to, you know, gain some perspective regarding mental health and things like that. All of them are CIT trained, which is pretty awesome. I definitely appreciate Miss Fonda for
Fonda
being
Bryant.
Up there. Yes, Miss Fonda Bryant, of course. You know, if you're in charge, you know Miss Fonda.
We love you, Miss Fonda.
Yeah, she's definitely dope. She definitely shared her story, which definitely shed light on suicide and, you know, and the things that she's doing in the community. So that was awesome.
Mm-hmm.
So we definitely had a great time with that. I got some things in the works. You know, they'll come out when they come out. You know how I am.
That's great.
But yeah, we definitely... We building. We're making some things pop.
We are.
You know, what you call us? We're D-list. So
well, I'm not. Well, I'm going to excuse.
Up?
Okay, wait. Yeah, I moved up. I want to talk about this because I told somebody this earlier, and I'm going to stand by it. I don't feel like I'm any longer on the D-list. I feel, Damion, that you're, I mean, you're right behind me. But I feel like since my because I feel like, have you been on TV?
Yeah, I've been on
TV. Okay, I equated with television. How many times have you been on? I equated with 3 times.
Really?
You asked me my opinion. I feel, for me, Damion, you can feel like a whole C-list celebrity right now. I'm a whole C-list, okay?
I don't care about labels.
I do.
I'm going to be who I am.
Okay.
If you know me, you know me. If you don't.
It makes me feel good about myself.
No.
I've labeled myself a whole C-list celebrity. You know what? It's not about C-list or the word celebrity. It's my personal... way that I keep track of my goals and what I'm achieving for myself. So I make a joke about it, but my friends know that. People that really know me, yeah, I don't give a damn about that. I buy people drinks when they recognize me in public because I think it's wonderful that people come up to us and say what the show does.
Oh, I appreciate it.
Yeah. No, I buy them drinks. It's that's so exciting. I like, I appreciate meeting our, you know, folks in the street, but you know, what I'm saying is honestly, it's about self-esteem and self-motivation and I just want to keep moving through all difficult emotions and all difficult things I go through. And, you know, sometimes people ask, like, oh, you got this going on, that going on, but you're doing this and doing that. And I'm like, no, I'm just focused on doing things to make myself feel good.
Right.
And joking like that actually makes me feel good.
Yeah, it's definitely, for me, it's not the notoriety or people knowing me out in public.
No,
obviously. That comes with a whole other blob of bullshit that you got to deal with when people feel like they know you because they've seen you on TV. Or whatever, or they follow you. Like, I don't really care about that.
No, our folks are good.
I treat people like I treat them. Normal, regular. Sometimes I'm an asshole.
Oh,
that's what it is.
What are you saying? Say it again.
Everybody, if you know me, you know sometimes that I can be a big asshole. Okay. It's okay. Mm-hmm. I'm very self-aware, and I know that. Stubborn, all that. Ooh. It's good.
Wow.
Yeah, when you're able to say things about yourself that are not so pleasant, it takes away the power that other people try to use against you in
it
that.
Does.
So
okay.
If I already said I'm stubborn or I'm an asshole, you can't call me that and I won't be offended.
Okay. Don't call me an asshole.
You can call me jerk, whatever.
Well,
but I'm not really
not,
a
I'm
jerk.
I'm not that
Jackie calls me a jerk sometimes.
I tell Damion sometimes you're being a jerk. Right now you're being a jerk. And he goes, really? I'm being a jerk? I'm not trying to be a jerk. I'm just, and I said, okay. And we let it go. It's over after that.
That's cool.
Okay.
But, again, you guys, as always, this was a phenomenal show.
This was good. It was.
This was for the books. We're definitely
going to. This was cleansing. Oh, yeah.
Make sure you guys check out thecouch704.com. Check out everything we got going on. YouTube. At the Couch 704, you'll definitely see the revamped version or the edited version of this show. I'll have that on there. Check us out Sunday at 12 on Power 104.4. Internet radio. You can go to the website and just click on the link. It'll take you right to Power 104. All right, you guys, and that'll be on 12 o'clock. So if you miss this live, it'll be on the radio on Sunday, 12 o'clock. Check it out. We there every week. The Couch. The originators. We do this thing.
Damion slid in
a I'm
the originators.
Hey,
mental health.
You gotta do your research.
Internet radio show. Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot out there now.
You gotta know who's in your pocket. You know what I'm saying? But we're definitely different for sure. Right. That's our hashtag. We're different. We do it differently. It is what it is.
It is what it is.
I love it. I love it, you guys. Hey, we gonna check y'all out next week, man. Same time, same channel.
Bad channel.
Yes, from myself, Dame Dash, a.k.a. whatever else you want to call me, not your average therapist, to my co-host, the TV personality, Fox 46 resident, whatever you want to call it, Jaqueline, a.k.a. Damn It Jackie, a.k.a. Jacqueline. A.K.A. Diane's. She's waiting. See, I wasn't going to go there.
Damien's trying to get a rise out of me, and it worked. Apparently, I was about to jump out of my seat.
And y'all would have saw the attack.
Okay.
Y'all would have had witnesses.
Thank y'all for tuning into the show, and thanks for sharing it.
Thank you, guys.
And thanks for commenting.
Appreciate it. Peace. See y'all next week.
Bye.
Hit that right there, Jack, for me. Okay.